Hello, fair raiders, and welcome to my humble abode. Last time I discussed the 5 spookiest creatures in Tomb Raider Chronicles, and that was a delight. But now let's move on to something a bit different. 1 year ago, I ranked all main Tomb Raider games in a big video that apparently only a few handful of people actually watched. And indeed it was a piece of work, but not everyone enjoyed it. I'm not going to rant against the people just looking at the chapters and not even making an effort to listen to the actual reviews. No. But I would like to share the very first comment that was posted a few hours after the video was published. It's not a negative one, mind you, but it made me realize that ranking the Angel of Darkness at the 10th position was heresy for some people. But be realistic, I wasn't that harsh with the Angel of Darkness, was I? The real heresy was ranking it above the 2013 reboot. I think I might be the only person on the internet to have done that. When I made the decision to rank the Angel of Darkness at a higher position than the reboot, I chose to make my reviews as positive as possible, to show that in spite of its many flaws, the Angel of Darkness had some respectable qualities that the reboot didn't. And if you look at the list, the Angel of Darkness is ranking almost as high as Legend, the game that, quote unquote, saved the franchise, and the very first installment. Come on buddies, this is not WatchMojo. I actually play the games I review, and I've been Tomb Raiding all my life. I made it quite clear in the vid. So today I wanted to share with you the 5 best levels in the Angel of Darkness, just to show you that yes, that game had its own sparks of genius. So let's go. The Archeological Dig was a pleasant surprise. It's really hard to distinguish from the Tomb of the Ancients because these two are connected. The Tomb of the Ancients almost made it in the list because it's vertical and sprawling, but I had a soft spot for the Archeological Dig instead.
Archaeology's fun, kids.
Everything revolves around that puzzle door in the middle, and your goal is to crack it, because you are a Tomb Raider, right? You have to pick up the clues, climb, explore, shoot people that speak a language sounding like gibberish, but you know they don't want to take a picture with you, right?
On bouge plus.
And this was probably the first time I actually read what was in the notebook. I mean, for something other than just curiosity, because I had to, because I was stuck, like, really stuck. Because the level is also very linear, so if you don't do everything in the correct order sequence, you're screwed. So pay attention next time. Oh, and that final jump was a bit difficult to nail, but who doesn't like a good challenge? I never expected there would be an underwater level ranking in my personal top 5, but actually it's a very clever one. Everything about the Vault of Trophies is memorable. The tunnels, the traps, the rooms, the statues, the pits, the platforms, the library, the 200 knights. Anyway, the more I think about it, the more I realize that level is probably one of the most complete, and the sudden difficulty spike makes it one of the hardest in this part of the game, which is a good thing, especially towards the end. The level is very intense and uses different mechs, like using the notebook to solve the puzzle, the aqualung, or even the upgrade that enables you to pull the chain to the left of the tapestry. The vault is the kind of level that made me understand the Angel of Darkness was a game superior to the reboot, because it is original, because it has its own personality. So if you're a fan, stop hating on me because the Angel of Darkness was number 10 in my list. See, I like it! And I have just begun. The Galleries is a fan's favorite, and the very reason why some players tagged that game so much. It was everywhere in the pictures you could see in the magazines, and that's also why the devs at Core Design were starting to feel overwhelmed, because they knew that the hype was creating expectations they couldn't meet. But they were badass enough to make a few levels that will be remembered as long as Tomb Raider exists, and the Louvre Galleries is part of it. Like the others in my list, it feels like a Tomb Raider level, and yet stealth had never been much of a focus before the Angel of Darkness. The only exceptions I can think of would be the high security compound in Tomb Raider 3 and the final chapters in Chronicles, respectively my favorite and least favorite Tomb Raider games.
No.
What?
You know they say there's a fine line between genius and madness? Well, that's the line between Tomb Raider 3 and Chronicles in my humble opinion. But back to the Louvre. It was of course a fantastic idea to have Lara sneak into such an iconic place. The inspiration for this novel didn't come out of nowhere though. It came as usual from popular culture. And curiously, in 2003 there was this book everybody was fussing about. Was that a coincidence? I don't think so. But now you know why so many people like it so much.
Hey.
The spin-off levels taken aside, the Hall of Seasons is pure and simple Tomb Raider. Well, core design Tomb Raider. Let me explain. The idea is that there was this level in the first installment that was built around a main area that would sprawl into several mini-areas you could call spin-off levels. And typically there were four, and that's essentially what the Hall of Seasons does. The level design is very intricate, and I like it when it's a little spicy, when you have to make sense of where to go. If you want to play it tough, you can do it. Or you can be lazy, just like me. The only downside to the Hall of Seasons was that it was clunky. Look at the boss fight, for example. But on the positive side, it used the new fatigue mechanics in a small way. You had to climb to the top of the dome to reach the first Obscura painting, and you had to unlock a specific upgrade to be able to do it. The four spin-off areas were just as good, as they had their own mechs, and their respective designs were very unique and challenging in their own way. Yes, the Sanctuary of Flame was a pain in the butt, but that's because some players didn't figure out you had to wait for the eruptions to subside. And in any case, you actually had a choice. And the Red Ghost, hoo boy, that level never ceases to amaze me. My favorite level and the absolute best in my opinion is the Bio-Research Facility. Yes, I make a distinction between favorite and best, and so should you. Anyway, I really like the level design. It's the reason why I play Tomb Raider games, in fact. So here is a little recipe I came up with.
Then I suggest you give it to me now!
You take a familiar place like the Great Wall of China,
bigly,
the Pyramids of Gizeh, or the fucking British Museum, and you end up in some kind of place reflecting the local cultural beliefs in a fantastic way, like a grotesque fairy tale. And the more surreal it gets, the more I like it. The Bio-Research Facility is a gigantic puzzle, and it uses verticality to its best advantage, with gaps and broken edges, telegraphing your progression. I like it how the game revolves both around the past and the present, how Prague became synonymous with something really spooky. The Bio-Research Facility gave me that surreal environment I was longing for. There are traps, monsters, including that freaking huge fish, but my favorite part was killing that giant mutant vine standing in your way, and you noted how you had to turn the valves to do it. I think that might be a clue as to which game the devs at Core Design drew inspiration from. Yeah, maybe a little. Anyway, thank you for watching, don't forget to leave an impression, a good one if you can, and I see you in the next video. Oh, and remember,